But to talk more about this, we are joined this morning by Commissioner Human Rights Commissioner Gwen Pimentel-Gana. Good morning, Commissioner Pimentel-Gana. Thank you for joining us.
Good morning, Mike. Good morning, Nikki. And good morning, everyone. May buntag sa tanan.
May buntag, Commissioner. Let me begin with Malacañang's reaction to the CHR's new drug war report. Presidential spokesperson Martin Andanar calls it a rehash of old issues. And contrary to your findings, he says the Duterte administration is leaving a legacy of a safe and secure Philippines. But you're saying the Philippine government failed to protect and respect human rights and has, in fact, encouraged impunity. How so?
Well, Mike, it's not a rehash because actually we released a partial investigation report last year, but this is a continuation of a report on the national perspective or scale, because at the first, the initial report was concentrating on cases in Region 3 and Region 4A and the NCR. Now the release is about the whole, EJK cases in the country. So it's not a rehash. And what is alarming there is that we have actually confirmed the findings in the previous results with the findings that we have when we look at the whole picture of what happened in the whole country. So it's not a rehash at all. And I'm just sad that they're saying that they're as if that nothing happened. I think it's about time that government, of course, realize that in the perspective of human rights, you know, when you look at the lens of human rights, the drug war has led to a lot of numerous individuals dying under suspicious circumstances. So I think this deserves a lot of attention from government.
And you're saying that the government has, in fact, encouraged impunity. What's the basis for that statement, Commissioner?
In a sense that there were roadblocks in the investigation. Number one was that we had a difficult time in getting documents from security forces or the authorities. And at the same time, there were like incidents where no cooperation from the security forces. When I say that, the police or other agencies of government where we reach out and they would not give any documents to us. At the same time, there was like a culture of fear, no protection could be given to family members or maybe witnesses that would come out to talk about what they saw. So there are certain instances, and that number, another one also would be like there would be few perpetrators that will brought to the courts of justice. So these are things that, are red tags and alarming that the government is not serious in really fighting these criminals and that bringing them to justice.
Now, you mentioned the lack of access to police reports. That's one of your key findings in your drug war report. And you're saying that this is not limited to the Philippine National Police structure. This goes all the way up to the president because supposedly of a presidential directive. Give us a sense of how this presidential directive is being used to essentially stonewall the investigations.
Well, when the president or any person in authority would give a directive, of course, anybody under the structure of government bureaucracy would follow. So these directors were given as an excuse whereby the police would not give us the records because there would be a directive that you need permission before documents can be released. So these are actually, I would say, limiting the freedom of information being given to human rights organizations like the CHR.
Has this directive by the president been challenged? Commissioner, has anyone questioned this directive? Why is the president limiting access to these police records?
I believe not formally, no, but we as CHR have been writing to the bureau, the head of the PNP, or even the office of the president, asking that they please allow the documents to be released to us.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because and the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court has said, at least in an order on the drug war killings, at least on Operation Tokang, that these police records are not state secrets. And they're not really, they do not belong to a classified information that should not be released to the public.
Yes, I believe that they did share to the Supreme Court. But when we asked them to give us those records, again, they were not made available to us.
Mm-hmm. All right. Now, beyond the police, though, how is the CHR's relationship with the Department of Justice? Because we've heard Justice Department officials say before, the CHR will be involved in the drug war review. But were you, in fact, asked to participate?
Well, I would say that Justice Guevara has really been open. And, you know, he's very welcoming about inputs from us. And he's actually showed his hand in cooperation. And we've entered into a memorandum of agreement whereby we will share documents with each other, the DOJ and the CHR. And I know that Secretary Guevara is very sincere with this, though. But whether or not our findings are actually given weight when they come to their investigation, I don't really know.
But have you been able to at least look at the records of the two drug war reviews they're doing?
They gave us the matrix of the cases that they are reviewing.
The same matrix that was released to the public and to the media?
Yes.
Nothing else?
Nothing else. We have not received so far the updates on those investigations that they've done on the cases that they've given us.
Mm-hmm. So what's your assessment of a DOJ's drug war review so far? So there are at least, two drug war reviews. The first report was never released to the public. The second one, they released a table, the one that you mentioned, the matrix of 52 cases.
Well, I guess they're doing their best with that investigation. We have not been updated as to the progress of those investigations. And we hope that they would share with us whatever findings they have on those cases, because we're also looking into those cases that actually they've listed down, and we've investigated some of those cases too.
So those drug war reviews by the DOJ so far covered, aside from the 52 cases in the second drug war review, there are about 300 in the first drug war review. But in contrast, the CHR opened 3,790 probes. It concluded 2,305 investigations. And your study included 882 cases. So how was the CHR, with its limited budget, able to conduct these many investigations and come out with its report when the DOJ could not and has not released its own reports?
We have regional offices, Mike, no? And the regional offices would conduct also their own investigations. And we've really made this a priority because of the lots of reports to us. And of course, it's a concern, a human rights concern, AJK, no? So we prioritize these cases. And we have actually concluded, as you said already, those figures, no? And we've investigated those cases to study the pattern of the kind of killings that were done in these particular cases, drug-related cases. So that's how probably we were able to garner a lot of conclusions from these studies, because we prioritized these cases.
Mm-hmm. This is not a reflection, Commissioner, of the lack of willingness to investigate on the part of government.
Well, I don't want to judge them on that, no? But the results will actually show the seriousness of their intent to investigate. That's I think, the conclusion that you can draw. Because after all, with the vast resources of government, how come these are only the cases that have actually gone into a stricter scrutiny when it comes to the drug war?
But do your findings echo the results of the DOJ's drug war probe? For instance, they found out there are lack of records, lack of processing of weapons use, multiple gunshot wounds and suspects, among others. Are these findings also indicated in your report?
Yes. Yes.
So in a way, it somehow confirms what's already been the findings of the DOJ. And how is it possible for the Malacañang to say that this is a rehash of old issues when its own agency, the DOJ, has already made similar findings to your report?
Precisely. Maybe they should answer that.
All right. Now, based on your findings alone, can we conclude that there is intent to kill in these operations? Because let me cite the figures here. Of the 798 incidents in your report involving 1,014 victims, 920 of the victims were killed. Only 87 survived. So do these figures alone, do they negate the claim that these are legitimate police operations?
Well, that's why they should investigate this more. Because number one, as you pointed out, the location of the wounds would be telling. You know, in this particular cases, like Danlabad cases, most of the victims were shot in areas that would really show that there was an intent to kill. The head, the chest, and sometimes you'd also wonder why they would be shot when in fact they're only one and the security forces are surrounding them. You know, couldn't they have been disarmed? You know, these things like that. So there are so many circumstances that would actually raise so many questions. So I think these are red flags that must be investigated. It calls for further investigation. That is why our report have recommendations, because that's what we want the police to do. Be serious in really investigating these cases.
Now, given the lack of records, though, is there still hope for relatives of drug war victims to obtain justice within the Philippine legal system? Because we're talking about cases that have lasted for years or they've been pending for years, and the difficulty of getting witnesses, the difficulty of getting records and maintaining them, preserving them for presentation in court. You are facing these several obstacles.
You know, Mike, I think that is what we should establish, that government is serious in pursuing these cases. Because when government is serious, the witnesses will feel confident that they are safe. You know, you have to provide this environment of security and safety for the witnesses to come forward. It is very important that they must feel that justice can still be served to them. So that is important. That is why the CHR is here to assist them. At the same time, we are calling on the police so that they will be able to protect even these witnesses, no, mm-hmm. and the family members, because they are scared. Those are one of the reasons why cases cannot prosper, is the fact that witnesses would back out because mm-hmm. they are scared that they can be the next victim. You know, so we have to create this culture of safety and they should feel protected.
Commissioner, correct me if I'm wrong, but your report did not go so far as laying the blame on the president, connecting him to the drug war killings. Is that an accurate assessment?
You know, we study the circumstances surrounding incidents that would lead to our conclusion. No, we are short of saying that this is state sponsored, but we are saying therefore that the state should show their seriousness in pursuing that justice is served to the victims of this drug war.
Mm-hmm. But in the context of the ICC investigation, Commissioner, won't these findings be taken against those who are seeking justice under the ICC, saying, for example, the CHR, the National Commission on Human Rights in the Philippines, did not actually pin the blame on the president? Can they actually use this particular findings in the ICC to defend, you know, the Philippine government?
You know, the ICC has its own procedure, and and if they want to take into consideration a report, then of course they can do so as part of the evidence or the documents that they will consider in assessing whether or not the president or anybody involved in the drug war will be found guilty or at fault. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So in your view, this will not in any way lessen the chances of, you know, the ICC eventually investigating the president himself in connection with the drug war?
Yes, the ICC can use any evidence in the that they can gather in order to pursue the case.
All right. Now, Commissioner, what will happen to these drug war reviews under a Marcos presidency? And do you see the drug war killings under a new president?
Well, the presumptive president and the new administration, I think, would continue with the drug war, no? And we're just hoping that they will recalibrate their approach to the drug problem. Now, I see that if they are really serious in pursuing the justice is served, they should continue with the investigations of these victims and the cases already pending. And they should actually continue to review the cases and then bring to justice the perpetrators. It's their obligation, because this drug war has actually lost, had so many deaths of innocent individuals also. So they should continue seeking the justice is served to these victims.
And how significant will the choice of a new justice secretary be in the whole context of this drug war review?
Of course, very significant. That the secretary of justice must look at the problem in the lens of a human rights approach, you know. That person must have a sense of a very strong sense of justice and fairness, and that person must be credible in a sense that people will believe that he will really pursue what is best for the victims of the EJK.
All right. Dagang salamat for joining us this morning, CHR Commissioner Gwen Pimentel-Gana.
Thank you. Bye-bye.